I'm from Argentina. I moved to Australia when I was 19. Though I do the world in alphabetical order, but stopped when I realized Austria was next. It might sound funny to you, but my proudest achievement is that I have a job. I know most people have jobs, but most people did not go through what I went through growing up. It wasn't Argentina. I just didn't have a very nice life. But that's the past. When I first moved here, I worked as a cleaner and a fruit picker, but the work never lasted. It was hard to find a real job, especially as a foreigner with no skills or experience, until I came across this ad in the local paper. A man by the name of Brian answered, and after a few minutes, I knew it was real. He sounded too legitimate. Brian said they would give me a try, and I cried with gratitude. He said it was great how much passion I was already showing. My first morning came around, and I went to a funeral. Some might say this is a bad way to start a career, but I'm not a superstitious person. The deceased was an old lady by the name of Ming Chu Smith. It was a small procession, and I stood near the end of the second row. I did not know Ming Chu, and I wasn't sad about a stranger passing away. But there were all these people standing around, and not a single one of them was crying. Half of them looked bored, like they wanted to leave and watch TV. This poor woman, she had been here for 89 years, and no one loved her enough to cry. It was so sad. I mean, what's wrong with these people? This poor old lady must deserve at least one good sob. She had been someone's mama, someone's grandmama. Maybe when she still had her own teeth, she was someone's lover. She was certainly kind to animals, a good neighbor. I couldn't imagine how sad I would be if it was my own darling Nana. All of a sudden, the tears started flowing, and I let out a noise. And the woman next to me gave a sniffle, and the woman next to her choked. And before you know it, they are all moaning and weeping and screaming, "Why, God!" After the service, a man with red, swollen eyes came up to me and gave me a big hug. "Thank you," he said. Mama told us on her deathbed that all she wanted was for everyone to cry at her funeral. I put in a good word to your boss. Brian was very happy with the report from Ming Chu's son, and I passed the test. $200 per funeral they paid me, plus a travel and tissue allowance. The work depended on clients, but it was up to 10 per week, sometimes 3 or 4 in one day. Did you know over 150,000 people die daily? You'd be surprised how many people hire a crier. The second funeral was for a middle-aged loner. I think I was really there to make up the numbers. It was hard to feel anything. So I thought about how sad it was that so few people cared about him after 56 years of life. And I managed to cry quietly while his three relatives watched on solemnly. Most of the time, I would turn up late to avoid those "how did you know her" conversations. And it was often difficult to find a reason to cry about dead strangers. But I always managed it, and the friend or relative who hired Brian's company would go home happy. Well, not happy. One day I discovered that being a funeral fluffer has its dangers. They were burying one of the best looking guys I have ever seen in my life, and I started my routine. A sniffle. A sudden sob. A pretend cough to cover it. The tears started flowing, and I wiped my eyes with a wad of tissue. I openly cried in deep, pitiful despair. "This is an amazingly beautiful person. I didn't even know or care about. He's being dumped in the earth for good. I mean, it's just so goddamn free. me by the arm and drags me away from the congregation. So you're this slut! You have some nerve showing up here. Who are you?
I'm just here to pay my respects.
Everyone knows Rocco's wife. She slapped with me when I corrected her with me, though. Turns out Rocco's sister hated her guts and hired me because she knew her sister-in-law would make a scene and embarrass herself. Unbelievable. The next day, I was so rattled, I went to the wrong service, crying like I had never been sad in my life, until I got the angry text from Ryan asking me where the hell I was. He'd call and chastise me, until I sob out an apology, and we both laugh at the irony. Things go smoothly for a couple of months after that, until a prominent radio commentator dies and a dozen criers are brought in to make it look like he wasn't reviled by the entire country. I wonder, what makes a person hate his fellow man as much as this man did? And how much everyone hated him in turn? And the whole thing makes me cry. The others that came with me haven't started yet, and I think, really? These amateurs need their own crier to get them started? I hear a... But before my grief has a chance to affect the people around me, I hear a commotion coming from outside. I try to ignore it. But it gets more and more commotionary, and I realize it's protesters. Can you believe it? What kind of sick person would protest at a funeral? Security guards and funeral staff trying to get it under control, but it continues. People aren't mourning. They're too distracted. So I get up, and I mush it. There's three rows of angry men and women holding placards and chanting. I shout at them. He's dead, you idiots! Do you think he was a bad man because of what he said on the radio? Is that it? Well, yes or what? He didn't listen to you when he was alive, and he is certainly ignoring you now. All you are doing is upsetting his friends and relatives, and none of us have done anything wrong. What you are doing makes you no better than he was. Let us mourn in peace. Some of them look down in shame. They didn't go away, but they stopped at chanting, and I went back inside. The woman next to me gave me a big smile and a congratulations. I slapped at her and said, "Stop the bloody waterworks." The next week, I got a call from the hospital in Argentina. My nana has died. I flew home to say farewell, and I'm sadder than I imagined a person could be. The funeral is more or less like any other I've been to in the last year, except for one big difference. I can't cry. The person I love most in this world, and nothing I think of can bring even one tear. Forgive me, Nana. I cannot bear to spoil our last moments together with unclear eyes. But I didn't believe that. When I returned, I told Brian I was done. He wrote me a beautiful reference, but say he wouldn't give it to me until I did one last job. But I can't cry, I protested. I'm sure you can, he said. I pay you, even if you don't. I went, and he said on the service started. I gushed like a broken woman. All I could think of was my nana, and how ashamed I was not to have cried. What was wrong with me that I could cry for strangers and not for the woman who raised me? Brian offered me an extra 10% commission on top of my fee, and I kept the job. Every funeral I go to is for Nana, and every tear I shed is for her. But I still go home at the end of each day with a string of satisfied clients in my wake. Well, not my wake. Oh, I'm due to leave for my next appointment, so it's time for me to say goodbye. Goodbye, Nana. Thank you for the life you gave me. I love you. And I will cry for you again, surely. I will cry for you every day. sometimes three or four times.